Good afternoon, friends of the Ponte culture. My name is Sofia Mexilu, and today I will be your hostess to this virtual event for the presentation and promotion of the Ponte culture. Our guest today is Mr. Omiros Pachaturidis, founder and CEO of the Pirichis Academy, has MA in Public History and HOU MSc in Electronic Engineering, who will speak about the traditional costume of the Ponte Greek men, its effects, choices, and symbolisms. At this point, I would like to introduce to you Mrs. Avgi Maria Atmatzidou, who is the organizer of the Open Lectures Ponte Culture virtual event.
Thank you so much, Sofia, for your presentation. I won't say many words because our special guest doesn't need an introduction. I just want to thank him for being here to our second open lecture about Ponte culture. And I would like to share something with you that Mrs. Pachaturidis is my personal inspiration for organizing all these lectures to the English-American, Greek-American and Greek-Australian audience. Thank you so much, Omire Pachaturidi, for being here with us today. You are a great inspiration. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Atmatzidou. And before Mr. Pachaturidis can start with his lecture, I would like to make a small introduction about his life so far. So, Omiros Pachaturidis has been involved in the performance and empirical teaching of Pontian dances for more than 30 years and is taught in a number of associations, Pontian and non-Pontian. Indicatively mentioned are the associations of Pontian Melissia, Agias Varvaras, Halandri, Nikia, Chania, Haidari, Argos, Menemeni, Lefkoto Poseron, etc. He has studied the wide range of the Ponte culture, like music, songs, costumes, and has made numerous relevant presentations to Pontic and non-Pontian, as well as world conferences. Some of those are dance conferences of the CID UNESCO 2013, 2015, 2016, 2018. He's been a member of the Culture Committee and WTO Rapporteur for Greek Pontic men's costumes for a number of years. Also coordinator of the Pompontian Festival 2010 and 2013 for all the clubs of Southern Greece, and coordinator of the Pyrrhic dance Sera for all the clubs of Attica from 2013 to 2018. And then 2017 for all clubs in Greece, as well as assistant director of the Anniversary Festival 2019. At the same time, he has been a member of boards of Pontian associations and is a member of the Pontian Studies Committee. Holds MSCI from NTUA Electrical Engineering and MA from EAP Public History and has graduated from the Samos School of Pamak, which is the University of Macedonia, for the Greek traditional dance, while he's the collaborator of the Theater of Greek Dances, Dora Stratou. Also teacher of Pontian dances and collaborator of the International Dance Council, CID UNESCO. He was also a research consultant and executive consultant of the performance of contemporary dance physical theater Genocide by the creator choreographer Pavlos Kourtlidis, with reference to the events of the genocide of the Greeks of Pontus. He is the inspirer and founder of the cultural organization Pirichis Academy, which originates with the culture in general and the dance education of the Greeks of Pontus. Organizes parallel educational activities with the aim of preserving and promoting the values that stem from the Pontian tradition. He has also prepared the study Pontian Dances Chronicles 1 with the help of the author Michalis Karavelas, focusing on the cultural and social approaches of the kinesiological style of performance of Pontian dances and the practices of preserving its characteristics in the future. Mr. Pachaturidi, thank you so much for being here with us today. Whenever you're ready, you can start with your presentation.
I would like to thank you also very much for the invitation. It's my honor to be with you and have this presentation and regarding the Pontian Greeks men's attire. We'll have to say many things about this. But first of all, Avgi and Sofia, thank you very much for this opportunity. I think that both of you and especially Avi are doing a great job regarding Pontic culture. And I wish also from Athens, Greece, the best in your efforts in the future. So, in order to start slowly, we will focus today on the men's costume in the area of Pontus, which I suppose it's familiar to you in the northeast of today Turkey's Republic territory. And we will start with a traditional definition, traditional attire definition, given by Professor Don Yoder from US. It's a clothing scheme which represents the identity of community outwards and signifies the multiple relations of the individual towards and within the community. This is, let's say, the perspectives that we're going to treat the costume, and not in, let's say, in other ways. So in order to go back a little bit in history, this is a map of the Ottoman Empire during the, from 14th to 19th century, where, as we may see, also the area of Pontus was under the Ottoman Empire. One of the most important researchers and, let's say, scholars of the Ottoman Empire history is Donald Cotard. He has passed away a few years ago. And in his, let's say, essays, The Cambridge History of Turkey, for the last centuries, he is describing the status of the social roles in the Ottoman Empire. So between the 16th and the 18th century, there was a mass regulation on dressing behavior for pointing out the differences between officials and subjects and between their groups for specific headgears, garments, belts, shoes, and the particular colors for every one of them. This was considered as tools of political, social, and economical controls by the Ottoman government. From the 18th century and till the beginning of 19, there was a development of new social groups, mostly merchants, Muslim or Christians or Jews, resulting to a plethora of law concerning attires during 18th century for denouncement of obscene, peculiar or wrong colored garments and accessories. This firman was issued by the Sultans and Osman and Mustafa III, mostly for Greek, Armenian and Jews. In order to clarify a little bit about this, these groups having, let's say, financial development, they have started to wear colors, especially, that was meant to be worn only by Muslims. So this resulted to, as Donald mentions, to a plethora of laws in order to punish these behaviors. In the mid of the 19th century, the Sultan Mahmud II, he issued a new firman for the indiscriminately use of the fez by officials and subjects for the construction of an undifferentiated Ottoman subjectivity without distinctions. The situation in that time was that the Western, let's say, big powers like France, England, and so on, they were having a bad relation with the Ottoman Empire, so they instructed them to change their policy regarding their subjects. And this was the reason that Sultan Mahmud II, in order to stabilize his relation with the Western, let's say, powers, he started to think in a different way how to proceed in a more free environment and create a subjectivity that would be undifferentiated and without distinctions. They have presented to him in 1829 the headgear of affairs, which was originating in Morocco. And he considered this as a symbol for his subjects in order for them to look the same. It was a period that also the Janissaries, as we will see also later, some pictures of them, they was dismantled the corpse of the Janissaries. So there it was needed to have some new restructuring laws. If we go back in the centuries and the years, we can see what it was meant by the different colors and different kind of costumes for every social group. It was from police, from secret police, from the judges, from the religion, let's say, officials, and so on. This was a corpse of the Janissaries, and one very important, let's say, conclusion by Salim Deringil, a professor in the Bosporus University, in the Comparative Studies in Society and History from Cambridge University Press, was the invention of tradition as public image in the late Ottoman Empire during the 19th century. And as he concludes, another clear example of inventing tradition in an Ottoman context is the traditionally Oriental headgear, the fez, seen by Westerners as the ultimate symbol of Turkishness. Apparently of Moroccan origin, the fez was declared in 1832 to be the official head covering of all the subjects of the empire by Sultan Mahmud II. It was to be worn by Muslim and non-Muslim alike to abolish external distinctions between communities. Mahmud had abolished the Janissary corpse in 1826, and the new form of headgear was thus needed for a new army. Thus, the ubiquitous symbol of the Turk in the 19th century was only a relatively recent creation and an imported one at that. We may see now some characteristic photos. This is from 1907, from Constantinopolis, a military corp. This was the members of the parliament in the Ottoman parliament. Greek members. And here we can, in the next slides, we will see some photos from the different countries that was under the Ottoman occupation. Bosnia, from Kosovo, from Croatia, in Skopje, from Albania, Bulgaria, and in Thessaloniki, Greece, there's groups of Jews, and also Armenians in Constantinople and in the city of Mersin. So we can understand that this is from Epirus, Greece. We can understand that this headgear was worn all over the Ottoman Empire. Creta, Greece, you can see the police corps and also the usual people, ordinary people wearing it. This is from Serres city. And going back to the territory of Pontus, this is the teachers and the students of Trabzon School, the Fronisterion of Trapezundas, as it was called in that time in 1920, where all of them was it was mandatory to wear the fez as a headgear. Also another military corps in Constantinople, in the middle it's Mustafa Kemal and other pashas and officials of the Ottoman Empire. This was from the movement of the Neo-Turks in 1908, from where mainly the destruction of the Armenian and Greek communities has started. This is not the topic for our discussion, and we may see also some other photographs and pictures from this period. From 1922, a photograph in Smyrna from the Ottoman Turkish soldiers and heads of Greek people. And in order to have a more general view, the dark green color was the color of Islam, is also today remains as the official color of Islam, and the dark red was the color of the Sultan. In the year 1856, it was issued by the Sultan a new firman called Hati Humayun, focusing on the rights of for religion, freedom, and equality between all Ottoman subjects, providing also freedom of expression, resulting to the possibility for identification of the Greeks, also of the Greeks of Pontus, also for other communities. This was also a result of the Greek revolution in 1821 and the independence of the of Greece established around 1830. And also under the pressure of the continuous pressure of the Western big powers. So we can consider this as a modernization of the Ottoman Empire in that period. Going back to the Pontians and the Greeks of Pontus, the crypto-Christians, another phenomenon that was for centuries spread in this area, were revealed from the first years having as pioneers the Pontians from Cromney, a city around 90 kilometers from the Black Sea to the south, and the youngest mostly, almost everywhere in historical Pontus area, adapting the attire of the Caucasian tribes, Georgian tribes, Lazis, Megrelians, etc. The crypto-Christians was a phenomenon, most probably it's known to you. It was the people who, during daily activities, they was presenting themselves as Muslims, but inside their homes, they was still believing in Christianism, to make it, let's say, as a general description of the phenomenon. Especially the Lazis and the Georgian tribes in the eastern borders of Pontus, they had they have established resistance teams from 150, 200 years before against the Ottoman Empire, partisans, guerrillas, who was fighting against them. So their costume, which we can have a look here, It was like a symbol for the Pontian people against the Ottoman occupation of their land. They adapted these costumes. They adjusted them in their special, let's say, weather and social conditions, as we will see later on. And this costume, this attire, especially as a formal one, was spread all in all the area of Pontus, especially from the Greeks who was living there. We define first generation as the people who was born, lived in this area before 1922, let's say as a milestone. And according to their sources, we can find many, let's say, studies. The first and the most important one is from Demosthenes Oikonomidis in the Pontus Archive in 1929, where he is writing that the Turkish attire has strongly influenced the local Greek as it concerns of men primary and on women secondarily. This can be explained due to the fact that the men was was exposed publicly, but the women at that time, due to the environment and the ethics of this epoch, was mainly stayed at home. The first, he says, the first hat of he distinguished as a Turkish or Fas, the newest headgear of the Turks and considered national, which was taken by them also from the Vassal Christians. And in page 14, he describes that the zikra was worn ever since by the Lazars and by them was received from our people at the regions of Kormi, Santa, Trapezunda, and Damascus, as well as Olasa, another smaller city. Athanasius Parharidis in the History of Kromni, 1911, he also mentions that the Greek people and the Greco-Christians and especially the officials following the habits of the Turks were dressed like them without exception of the turbans and the tsupedes. Tsupedes was like a coat. Yeah. We can see here the coat, which was described as, which had the name of Tsupe. This is a photograph of around 1830 of Panagiotis Tokatlidis. We can find a lot more sources from the first generation written scripts. What mostly distinguished Matsuka from the other region was the women's attire, because men's was almost uniform at all provinces, at Sanda, etc., and other cities. And even the Turkish men attire was the same, and the only distinction was for some Turks, which were wearing as headgear the fez instead of the kukula, and wearing around the fez one white or yellow turban, and from that were distinguished. But the men wearing the kukula named paslik in Turkish was impossible to be separated from the Christians. There are many, let's say, references like this. Maybe it's useful to have a look on an aged man that he's wearing the kukula, the paslik in Turkish. These are Greeks from Udado village in Matsuka. And continuing with the references of the first generation, we can see that from Kromni, Christos Tsatsilidis mentions that during my times, most of men were dressed with trousers, but in the winter they wear zipkes. As everywhere at Pontus, also at Mousenas, villages were dressed with the local Pontian attire, where the women were wearing the zupunes and men the zipkes with the kukula, as Ioannidis is mentioning in Mousena. and many, many more that describes the Zipka as the formal official costume of the Pontic Greeks. Here we can see in the upper left team from Santa, and down to the right from Cromney, partisan teams against the Ottoman Turks. Furthermore, from the first generations, we can see some more references, like Eleftherios Eleftheriades from Larrachani in Matsouka, instead of Zipka, which is clearly an official attire and cannot be used for everyday work. They were wearing during working hours old Zipkes without armor and the kukula, old trousers and fez. A description of men's attire where I mentioned the basic elements of the Zipka and the kukula are also in the book of Xenophona Koglou, Xenos Xenitas of the Ortou Kotiora folklore, 1939. And here we can we can see a photograph from the Studia Pontica, a three-part book from Comont, which we can see in Nicopolis, the everyday clothing of the Greeks there, a family in, at Santa City. And going to different cities now, different areas from the eastern part in Rizunda, we can see also the men's attire, the epoch in Kotiora and in West Pontus, West area in Akdagmaten, where we can see the on the horse the landlord Kutsidis, who according to his official, let's say, role, he was he should wear also the fez. So we can understand that a photograph is not exactly only what we are looking at, but also have several meanings which is necessary to try to find on the background. These are other photographs from this period from the resistance teams. And please allow me to focus on the Pirichios Sera dance costume, the official, let's say, costume, the attire which should be worn when the men were dancing this this special, let's say, emblematic dance. All these references are coming from people who lived in Pontus. Mouzenidis mentions that the Sera dance should necessarily be, the Sera dancers should necessarily be dressed with zipkes, with all garment accessories, and at the same time be armed. We will see later on about the accessories. Pantelis Melanofridis, he mentions that the Sera dance, where the participate, where who participate should have specific qualifications, well looking, light footed, wear garment with the local zipka and the kukula. No Sera dancer could be allowed if he was dressed with breeches or fabric zipkes wear by the poor. The Demosthenes Economides, as we already have mentioned, one of the most important scholars of the era, says that it was to be mentioned hereby that only the Zipka leaders were dancing the famous Sera dance, as he describes in Pontus Archive in 1929. And Kostas Papamichalopoulos, a minister of the Greek state in 1903, he mentions that dance in which Sera dance in which usually were participating dancers wearing the full armor and garmenting with the local attire, the zipkas. we can, let's say, have some testimonies from first one. We have a look at some testimonies. First of all, we can see about the partisans of the Santa, most famous partisan team of the Pontic Greeks, which in 26 May of 1924, in their diary, they mentioned that during morning our ship arrived at the Amisos port, where we received more refugees and 40 prisoners, and departed from Constantinopolis, where we stayed 2 days, for 2 days, because of a ship damage and its repair. As soon as we left at Armenia and reached Greek Sea, a fever was heard by thousands of mouths, and the sea became red from the faces which were thrown into the sea, last peck brought from Turkey. We can see distinction of the fez also here in the surrender of the Ioannina from the Sarpasa to the King Constantine in 21st of February 1913. Sorry. And we can have also the testimony of Tito
Salamis. Να κλαίνε. Πολλοί κατεβήκαν κάτω, βγήκαν στον δρόμο, αρχίσαν και τους φιλούσανε. Υπήρχαν και μερικοί διαβάτες οι οποίοι φορούσαν κόκκινα φέσια. Τα βγάζανε τα κόκκινα φέσια και τα πατούσανε και φωνάζανε.
So we can see also from this description and the previous one how strange and how hostile it was the fez for the Greek of Pontus as a symbol of the Ottoman occupation. We can see now from the Greek territory, from the Greek state in 1937 in Ptolemaida, the men's attire, the player of the lira, of the kemenge. Also in Skidra in 1938, in Athens, one of the most famous and important association, Argonautes Komnini, Pontians Club, in 1940s, in the middle down is the Nikos Papavramidis, one of the most famous singers and players of lira, a teacher of all later players and singers. We can see in northeast Greece from Kavala, 1963, the establishment of Panagia Soumela in Vermio, in Veria, Christos Bairaktaris, also another famous singer like Nikos Papavramidis came from Kromni in Greece. And Domna Samiu, which most probably is known to many people to its her work. Both of them have passed away several years ago. Christoforos Christoforidis, Stoforon, as he was called in Tetralophos Kozani, was born 1905 in Kunaka of Matsuka. Died also, passed away also several years ago, also a singer and player of Zurna. The most famous dancer, born in 1880 approximately, from Abelia village in Trabzon, Nikos Kalousis, came in Greece in 1924, if I remember well. He died in 1969. He was the teacher of all our major. He was the pioneer of the Pontic dances in Greece, and together with George Firtinidis, also from Kromni, all of them, as we may understand, have passed away several years ago. But we can see how the clothes they're wearing, the clothing, the costumes they're wearing, in order to show that they are Greek Pontians. We will come to that also later on. But first of all, let's have a description of the costumes, of the men's attire. Kukula or Paslik is the name of the headgear. Paslik is the Turkish, Kukula is the Greek, let's say, name. Kamis, it's from Kamiso, shirt, the gilek, the vest, Abbas was the name of the jacket. Zipka is the type of the trousers. Mestia and Tsapulas were word or boots. Boots was, let's say, many people was wearing boots because many people was going to Russia for work and to the Soviet Union at that time or to the Russian, let's say, areas for work. So they brought them from there. Tarapolos was a silk or cloth belt. We will see a photograph later on. Salachlik was a leather belt, the knife, and some accessories that we can have a look in this picture. I think it's more or less clear. This is one kind of uniform. The one in the background, which you will see, it was more like partisans. Uniform, this was weared, let's say, in celebrations and other social events where bullets and guns was not so sophisticated to be weared, let's say. From Epitropi Pontiacum Eleton, we can have some prototype samples, useful as especially for tailors. In the upper right is the jacket. In the middle up is the shirt. In the left is the kukula. And down is the trousers, the zipka, from name from which it was named all the attire. And some details of the accessories, the knife, of the Selachlik and so on. You can see St. George in the upper left. And we can conclude, let's say, that the Zipka costumes faced the Catholic free acceptance as the representative attire by the total population of the Pontians of the first and the second generation. As I already have mentioned, the first generation are named all the people which were born at Pontus as an essential element of self-identification and reparation of the common feeling or remembering the opposition efforts against the Turks. The genocide of the Greek Pontians is the milestone of our recent history. Pogroms, deportations, mass murders, persecutions were symbolized, are symbolized, and will continue to be symbolized through this attire, zipka and kukula. This attire is the living and acting component of the most of the common dramatic historical course of the Pontian Greeks. Finally, let me add that the attire of the Pontian men have been included in the Evzones Presidential Guard of Greece since more than 10 years ago. Of course, it's clear the 353 and 30 is the meaning the 353 dead of the genocide of the Greek Pontian. And let me, allow me please, as I always concluding my presentations, to conclude with some photographs from the genocides which must be never forgotten. Thank you very much. I'm at your disposal if there are any, say, questions.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Mr. Paraturidi. Now, Mrs. Atmadzidou has gathered some questions for you from the social media platforms.
Congratulations, Omire. This journey, it was really emotional, I can say. Thank you one more time. And I would like to ask, what kind of materials were used for the production of zipkes?
Uh, Mainly as a formal costume, it was manufactured by felt, a kind of blanket, due also to the special weather conditions of the area, especially in the mountains, was very cold in the winter, and it was needed this the materials to be strong enough to help the people resist in the low temperatures and the heavy snowfalls. Of course, there was also other more cheap productions from, let's say, simple clothes, but the people who had, let's say, the money, they was buying from felt, as I said, kind of a blanket in order to be more official for the formal social events and their presence there.
I have observed in your presentation that people with, let's say, the clothes of the poor, they weren't allowed to participate in the dancing groups. Why was that?
I would say that, first, let me clarify that this this observation was for the Pirichius dancera, not for all dances. This dance, I would say, that is the most important of all. And I don't think that in that period everybody was allowed to participate in this dance. So there was several criteria in order for a man or a younger man to be a member of a group who was dancing the Serra dance, the Pirichius. And one of these criteria was also the attire. There are several photographs. Maybe this could be the subject for another presentation, especially for the Pirichius dancera and the circumstances, this kind of criteria for the participants, the significance of the specific dance for our collective memory and identity, and where would be shown. I also have in my personal, let's say, archive, thanks to many friends that are also dealing with the subject, photographs from this period where we can see that only men with the full garment and the official attire was participating in this dance.
Okay, thank you. Historical predecessor of Zipkes during medieval ages, still the period before the first one you describe in the presentation.
Going back to the past, it's I consider very difficult. There are not a lot of references. It must be studied more thoroughly the Byzantium period, because during the medieval and until the 16th century, it was the dominating, let's say, social environment, this of Byzantium. And I think it is not so well studied till now from the scholars this period. So it needs more personally me, I haven't gone through this kind of research. I consider it's very time consuming, very difficult. I personally don't have the time also for this, but it's a very, very, very important and can solve many questions from our side. In general, I would say that the costumes of the Byzantine epoch was also, of course, weared also in Pontus area, and their origination can be found in the ancient Greece. This as a general conclusion, of course, a lot of research has to be done in this area, in this field.
Thank you so much. And my last question, during last 10, 15 years, we are noticing other kind of costumes presented by Pontic folk groups. What is your opinion about that?
This is an interesting question. I personally believe that the only costume that we should present in our representations, for various reasons, which I will explain, is the zipka with the kukula. I have also seen such efforts from, fortunately, very few groups, which, in my opinion, are how to say the efforts that has different perspectives. I would say that the instructor of these groups, they are trying to be distinguished from others in an effort of, how to say it, there are many reasons for that. One reason is the lack of knowledge. Another reason could be the vanity. Another reason could be the profit gain. Another reason, I don't know the reasons of everybody. What I can say is that according to my understanding, our collective memory and collective identity component, which is called men's attire, should be the one only zipper with the kukula and nothing else. And actually, with all its garment and armed, it's a symbolic, in my opinion, and I think it's obvious the symbolizations that comes through. It's a living, it's a living component of our memory and should be.
Thank you.
And at this point, we are at the end of our virtual event. I'd like to thank you, Mr. Pachaturidis, so much for your presence here and your lecture today to the Pontic American and Pontic Australian audience. And to all of you, thank you so much for watching.
Thank you also very much.